إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين تسليما كثيرا إلى يوم الدين يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا. We praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and we seek His assistance and we seek refuge in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from the evil of ourselves and the evil of our actions. Whoever Allah guides, he will be from amongst the guided people, and whoever Allah does not guide will not find any guidance. And I bear witness that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is his servant and messenger. May Allah send peace and blessings upon him and upon his family and blessed companions and all those who follow them until the day of judgment. I enjoin you and I enjoin myself to have taqwa of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to exhibit taqwa, which is avoiding the prohibitions of Allah and fulfilling the commands of Allah outwardly and inwardly. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون. تذكرون. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, إن الله كتب الإحسان على كل شيء. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that He has enjoined عدل and إحسان, justice and إحسان, excellence or perfection. And the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said that Allah has ordained that we excel in all things. Ihsan, excellence or perfection, He has ordained this in all matters. And the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam also, in describing what ihsan is, he said that it's to worship Allah as if you see Him. تَعْبُدُ اللَّهَ كَأَنَّكَ تَرَاهُ. And if you don't see Him, فَإِنْ لَمْ تَكُنْ تَرَاهُ فَإِنَّهُ يَرَاهُ. If you don't see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, know that He sees you. So what is it? What is this concept of ihsan that we see multiple times in the Qur'an? That we see when Jibreel alayhi salam came to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam in that famous hadith, which is known as Hadith Jibreel, and he asked the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam about four things. He asked him about Islam. Tell me what Islam is. And he said that you, the Shahada and fasting and prayer and so forth. And what is Iman? What is faith? That you believe in Allah and His books and His messengers and so forth. And what is Ihsan? And then he explained that you worship Allah as if you see Him, and if you don't see Him, then know that He sees you. And then he asked about the signs of the Day of Judgment. Later, when the Sahaba were asked by the Prophet ﷺ, do you know who this was? And they said, Allah and His Messenger know best. He said, this was Jibreel, he came to teach you your deen. So we get from this hadith that the deen are those matters that were asked about by Jibreel. So if Jibreel alayhi salam, peace upon him, is saying that ihsan, asking about ihsan, and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is answering him, then this is one of the pillars of our deen. This is one of the foundations of our faith and our practice of our faith. So we should know what exactly is ihsan. And how do we perform ihsan? Well, to begin, we have to understand what ihsan is and what ihsan is not. This is why when we read the ayahs in the Qur'an or the verses of the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we should pay special attention to what is being discussed there, what is mentioned before and what is mentioned after, the context of this hadith or the ayah. So in an ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَابْتَغِ فِيمَا آتَاكَ اللَّهُ دَارَ الْآخِرَةِ. Use those things that Allah has given you, those blessings that Allah has given you. Use those and spend them and seek out the next life. وَلَا تَنْسَ نَصِيبَكَ مِنْ الدُّنْيَا. Second point. And don't forget your portion of the dunya. وَأَحْسِنْ كَمَا أَحْسَنَ اللَّهُ إِلَيْكَ. And do ihsan. Have excellence. Perfect things just as Allah has had excellence with you. When we think of all of the blessings that Allah has given us, that alone should be a motivating factor to say, well, if Allah has given me so much, then let me give out in a perfect way to others around me. So Allah first said, use those blessings to seek the afterlife. Don't forget your portion of the dunya. And do ihsan to others just as Allah has done ihsan to you. And then he says, وَلَا تَبْغِي الْفَسَادَ فِي الْأَرْضِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُحِبُّ الْمُفْسِدِينَ. And don't oppress. Don't seek out transgression in the world, in the land, because Allah does not love those who transgress or those who are transgressors. If we back up to the other ayah as well, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in this ayah, and you'll hear a lot of, at the end of a lot of khutbas, they end this, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَأْمُرُ بِالْعَدْلِ وَالْإِحْسَانِ وَإِيْتَاءِ ذِي الْقُرْبَى. And this was actually implemented by Umar ibn Abdul Aziz. Why? Because at the end of the, or in the ayah, it says, وَإِيْتَاءِ ذِي الْقُرْبَى, that Allah orders you to have adl and ihsan, and to give to your family members, to be good to your family members. He found that at his time, a lot of people were treating the family of the Prophet ﷺ in an ill fashion. Jealousy, hatred, even hurting them and killing them. We're in the month of Muharram. We know what happened on the 10th of Muharram to the grandson of the Prophet ﷺ, Hussein, and how the people murdered him and massacred his family and what they did. So Umar ibn Abdul Aziz implemented this as a method in the khutbah to remind people, if Allah is telling you take care of your families, then what does that mean about the family of the Prophet ﷺ? This ihsan, this goodness that you're showing. But in this ayah, this, that Allah is ordering and enjoining ihsan and adl, he says Allah enjoins justice and excellence on all things. وَيَنْهَا عَنِ الْفَحْشَاءِ وَالْمُنْكَرِ وَالْبَغِي. And he forbids you, prohibits you from evil things, foul things, and transgression, baghi. So the opposite, we understand that the opposite of ihsan is transgression. If we are not showing ihsan, then we become transgressors. We become people of baghi. And baghi, as a quick device to remember what it means, sounds like bully, a little bit. Just change the lam to a ghain. Bully, baghi, same thing. Think of the bully. Think of what the bully does. And we might have all been in that situation where either we were bullied, or maybe we were the bullies. Maybe we were an employer. Maybe we were a spouse, a father, a mother, child, friend, classmate, co-worker, colleague, a peer. And now these blessings that Allah has given us, how are we going to use it in this interaction with this other person? Are we going to have ihsan just as Allah has given ihsan to us? Or are we going to transgress? Think of one of the ultimate bullies in the Quran, Fir'aun, and all that Allah had given him in terms of wealth and power and prestige amongst his people. And how did he treat Bani Israel? How did he treat the children of Israel? How does that bully, when Allah gives him strength, or gives her strength, or gives them the ability to speak very well? Sometimes a bully is just a sharp-tongued person that knows how to insult somebody really deeply and inflict that wound. So this power that Allah has given us, this ability to speak, maybe this ability for humor, maybe this ability for sarcasm, this blessing that Allah has given us as an employer, and now I'm over these employees, am I going to treat them well, treat my friends well, or am I going to use those blessings and hurt them? So that's how we know whether it's ihsan or baghi. It's either these blessings that we are given, where we were given to by Allah, we either use them in ihsan, in excellence and perfection of our faith, or we're using them in transgression. This position of authority that Allah gives us as a father to children, as a teacher to students, as an employer to employees, the position of having something that you could outdo somebody else with. Are we going to treat others well and be people of ihsan? Or are we going to hurt them and be people of baghi? So that's the first thing to remember, that ihsan has signs. If we're treating other people fairly and justly and perfectly, that's ihsan. Once we start losing that, we slip into the realm of baghi. But even before that, ihsan is linked to faith. We cannot have ihsan unless we have faith. The Prophet ﷺ, in discussing with Jibreel, began by answering questions about faith. What does it mean to be a Muslim? How can we be a Muslim? We believe in Allah and His messengers and the angels and the books and so forth. Then comes ihsan. Why is this important? It's important because when we look at the dunya, and we look at what people have been given, and the excellence that people strive for in the dunya, and the perfection that people have of the dunya, sometimes they consider that's ihsan. That's what it means when Allah says, be people of ihsan. That's what it means when the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says that Allah has ordained, إِنَّ اللَّهَ كَتَبَ عَلَى كُلِّ شَيْءٍ الْإِحْسَانِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ كَتَبَ الْإِحْسَانَ عَلَى كُلِّ شَيْءٍ Allah has ordained or said that you have do ihsan in all things. So these countries are major producers. They have factories, and look at what they're producing and their technology and so forth. And look at the Muslims. There's people who are analyzing the Muslim community and saying that a lack of our faith, of the Islamic faith, is because our countries are not producers like their countries. They'll actually say this and believe this. They believe that the sign of ihsan, of perfection in this life, is that you're producing material things. You're producing dunya. Oh, you made a great product. You have a great invention. That must mean that you're a person of ihsan. But if we look at the ayahs in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us, wa'budu Allah, worship Allah, believe in Allah, and then have ihsan towards your parents or so forth. As in the ayah where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, wa'budu Allah, worship Allah, which means that you believe in Allah first to be able to worship Him. وَلَا تُشْرِكُوا بِهِ شَيْئًا And do not associate partners with Allah. وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا And do have ihsan. Be good. Perfect your relationship with your parents. وَبِذِي الْقُرْبَى And with your family, your relatives. وَالْيَتَامَى And the orphans. وَالْمَسَكِينَ And the poor people. وَالْجَارِ And the neighbors, the close neighbors and the far neighbors. So this is how Allah is teaching us how to have ihsan. It's we have to have faith and worship, and then begins the process of ihsan. Otherwise, if we think that ihsan is somehow related to just the dunya, we go back to the ayah where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us, use those blessings that Allah has given you to seek out the next life, and don't forget your portion of the dunya. وَلَا تَنْسَ نَصِيبَكَ مِنَ الدُّنْيَا Don't forget about the dunya. One time when I was studying, there was a friend of mine, he came and one of the first questions that he had on his mind as he was sitting with the shiur, he said, I know in the community that I came from, there's this push to have their children, to have the youth excel in the studies, college, high school, and so on and so forth, and then to get the best job, even if it means sacrificing the deen at times, or not giving as much importance towards our faith and our practice of the faith. And the proof that these people are saying is that when they see their children trying to go towards the faith and more practice of the faith, they'll say, that's good, that's fine, you can practice Islam, but don't forget your portion of the dunya. And they use this ayah. وَلَا تَنْسَ نَصِيبَكَ مِنَ الدُّنْيَا Literally, that's what it means. Don't forget your portion of the dunya. So they're using this ayah to say, it's okay, you can have a little bit of Islam and a little bit of practice, but don't forget the major portion, your portion of the dunya. You have to get some portion of the dunya. Which is true, we believe this. We know the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us that we have to go out and seek the halal livelihood and support our families and support ourselves. We know that. The Muslims, a Muslim with a proper understanding of Islam has a strong work ethic. There's no doubt about that. But what does it really mean when Allah is telling us, don't forget your portion of the dunya? It's one of two things. Because once we leave this dunya, what do we leave with? Do we leave with our inventions, our patents, our 401k plans, our houses, our real estate, our holdings, our assets, our stocks? Do we leave with those? Or do we leave those to our inheritors to fight over? That's the reality. Once we leave this dunya, that's for the people to fight over after us. The only thing that we take out of this world is our good actions and our burial shrouds. That's the only thing we take out. For any of us who's been to a burial, and if you haven't, there's a very close cemetery here, Livermore, and there's a lot of ejr, a lot of reward to going to a burial and seeing the final rites that's given to a Muslim, to honor that Muslim, but also to remind ourselves of our own mortality. But when that person is placed in the grave, and the dirt is placed over them, what's the only thing that's theirs? That nobody else, then the inheritors can't come and say, hey, I want that burial shroud. It's the shroud that they're buried with. That's the only thing that we take out of this dunya. Everything else that we amass, all of the things that we get, that's for other people. And so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is reminding us, وَلَا تَنْسَ نَصِيبَكَ مِنَ الدُّنْيَا
Don't forget what you're really taking out of this world.
So when we have that perspective, when we think about what we're really taking, then when we approach the dunya, it's a different outlook. Yes, we can get the dunya. And yes, we can strive for excellence in the dunya. But we know that the only thing we're taking out is our good actions. So make sure that this good action that we're doing, this action that we're doing, is in line with the deen, brothers and sisters. We have to do that. We have to make sure that everything that we do is in line with the deen and that we're doing it really fi sabilillah. There was once somebody told me something and it was very disturbing. They walked into a organizational meeting of a nonprofit and somebody, and they were planning out their strategy. Do this, do that. And somebody looked at the strategy and looked at one of the points and said, well, isn't, if we did that, wouldn't that be haram? And the person immediately just responded saying, I don't care if it's haram, this is what we're going to do. When I heard that, I said, that sounds like those cutthroat corporate managers that when something is placed before them, they say, well, you're going to ruin the ecosystem of this country. You're going to cause them, I don't care, that's what we're going to do. So did they perfect the dunya and their achievements in the dunya and their procuring, getting their dunya? Did they do a good job of getting the dunya? Yes. But did they have ihsan? Did they have this excellence that's a form of worship, that's one of the pillars of our faith? No. Because if we have ihsan, then everything we do is getting us to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We don't believe that the ends justifies the means. That just because we're trying to get to the akhirah, that we can somehow take shortcuts and go around the deen and say, as long as I'm trying to get to that akhirah, as long as I'm trying to do good, it's okay if I hurt a few people in the pathway. No, that's not what we believe. We have to make sure that the blessings that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the blessings that He has given us, are used properly. So when we have this blessing, when we have this authority over someone else, we have this ability to do something, we make sure we say, am I doing this with ihsan? And a beautiful example, and this is why it's important to look at the context, is that when our Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he said, when he told us, إن الله كتب الإحسان على كل شيء, Allah has ordained and has ordered that we be perfect and we excel and we have excellence in all things. Let's look at the example that he gave us. This is a man who's rahmatan lil alameen. He's a mercy to all of creation. Alameen doesn't mean people. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen doesn't mean praise to Allah, the Lord of all people. It means the all of creation. So the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, after telling his Sahaba, and by extension telling us, he's speaking to us as well. We have to remember that. Yes, he's speaking to the Sahaba directly before them. But he also told the Sahaba, بَلِّغُ عَنِّي وَلَوْ آيَةً, convey this message. So when we hear the blessed words of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we have to remember, he's speaking to me. He's not just speaking to them. This is not merely a tradition or a historical analysis that we're doing. We're looking at something. He's speaking to every single one of us. So what is he trying to tell us? Allah has ordained that we have ihsan in all things. فَإِذَا قَتَلْتُمْ فَأَحْسِنُوا الْقِتْلَ وَإِذَا ذَبَحْتُمْ فَأَحْسِنُوا الذِّبْحَ. That when you kill, kill properly. If you're hunting, don't torture this animal. He's telling us about the ethics of hunting. And if you slaughter, if it's a slaughter that you're doing, then make sure that it's proper. And sharpen your knife. And let the animal have a merciful death. He's telling us exactly what we should be doing. And look at this, look at the context. When a person slaughters an animal, and many of us, we just got through last month celebrating Eid al-Adha by slaughtering an animal. When you're in that position, you have this blessing. Allah has given you this power and control over another creature. How are we going to do that? And that creature can't do anything to stop you. It can try, but pretty much we're in control. Now we have this blessing that Allah has given us. Are we going to do this properly and treat this animal properly? And any of you who have watched the ritual slaughterings of the Muslims, look at the way people actually slaughter the animal. Do they cover the eyes, for example, of a sheep? It will calm the sheep down and then it happens quickly. Or do they mistreat the animal? Do they mishandle the animal? And that's a good way, a good red flag, so to speak, that we can say, is a person really having ihsan in their life? Because if they're having ihsan in their life, then it's going to show up. So let's see how you slaughter an animal. Let's see how you treat children. Let's see when you come to a parking lot
Do you double park or park in a red zone or park in front of the fire hydrants? I know it's a constant thing that we talk about, but here we go again. Here's this blessing. You have a car. Yes, you have to get to the masjid. Are you going to sacrifice some ihsan so that you're trying to get to the next world and you're going to block people in? And that happens all of the time. And so it's a question that we should be asking, why am I lacking in this ihsan? I'm not doing ihsan to others as Allah has done ihsan to me. I'm only caring about myself. That's the problem. When we only care about ourselves, we're not having ihsan. We're not perfecting. We could come in and have a great prayer. That's not ihsan. When we hurt other people in the process to get to our perfect or so-called perfect prayer, that's not ihsan. Ihsan has to be the whole way, all the way to the actual form of worship. And this is why the Prophet ﷺ called those people who worship Allah and do a very good job of it, but they harm other people, he called them the bankrupt people. Because they have all of these good deeds that they've amassed, but they're going to have to give them out to the other people around them. So we look around at the meat production of the Muslim world and how people are treating them. Some people who came back from Hajj, they told me just recently, they said, I can't believe the way Muslims are treating animals during the Hajj and the sacrifice. Just because it's an act of worship, and just because it's the sunnah of Ibrahim alayhi salam, now we're going to take this blessings that Allah has given us over this animal and mistreat it? That's not ihsan, brothers and sisters. And we can apply this to any aspect of our life. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam reminded us to have be good, have khayr with the women of our community. Are we doing that? The husbands, the fathers, are we really being good to the women in our community and honoring them? And by extension, are the women honoring the men and having ihsan towards the people around us? And these are the questions that we can be asking ourselves to see, are we really having ihsan? One time I was, this was when I was in West Africa, and it's a pastoral society where they have animals, camels, sheep, so forth. And some of the people coming from outside of the country, from the West, would try to get into the culture and buy animals. And it seems simple. And so one time this person bought some goats, and then was having a bad day collecting the goats, and then he slapped one of the goats. And I remember there was a Mauritanian who was raised in this type of family where they would take care of animals. He just looked up at me with his face, and I'll never forget the way he looked at me, and he said, this is not proper. This is not proper. And I thought to myself deeply about that for a number of things. One, every single prophet had, at a certain point in his life, he was a shepherd. He was taking care of animals. And it's a training. They said the reason why it's a training of how to deal with people. Because that's the ultimate situation where you have complete control over this animal. You can kill it, you can hurt it, you can treat it nicely. And if you can perfect that way of dealing with a creature that you have complete control over, then when we go into our society, when we're in our schools, as teachers, as students, in our workplaces, in our families, then we say, am I going to use this power, these blessings, whatever I have been given, am I going to treat other people well? Or am I going to harm them? That's why one of the reasons why doctors will actually look for mistreatment of animals in children. If they're mistreating animals, this is a sign there needs to be some work with that child. And having pets is actually a good thing, because it'll give the child a chance to learn how to treat others. So as we're working towards ihsan, and we're working towards justice, we remember the verse of Allah, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَأْمُرُ بِالْعَدْلِ وَالْإِحْسَانِ, that Allah has enjoined us to have adl, to have justice and ihsan, وَإِتَاءِ ذِي الْقُرْبَى, and to give to our, and to be good to our relatives, وَيَنْهَى عَنِ الْفَحْشَاءِ وَالْمُنْكَرِ, and He forbids us from foul and evil things, وَالْبَغِي, and transgressions, يَعِلُكُمْ لَعَلَكُمْ تَذَكَّرُونَ, and He reminds us this so that we may have dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن والاه أما بعد فيا عباد الله أوصيكم وأوصي نفسي بتقوى الله اتقوا الله ويعلمكم الله يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا. We praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we send peace and blessings upon His last and final and most noble messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and upon all of his companions and family and those who follow him until the day of deen. I enjoin you and I enjoin myself to have taqwa of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala,
To have taqwa of Allah and Allah will teach you. Have taqwa of Allah and Allah will teach you. O you who believe, have taqwa of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and only say those things which are righteous words. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, إِنَّ رَحْمَةَ اللَّهِ قَرِيبٌ مِّنَ الْمُحْسِنِينَ. The mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is close to the people of Ihsan. The mercy of Allah is close to the people of Ihsan. So this should be a motivating factor to remind us of the benefits, that it's not only something that we're going to benefit from in the next life, this Ihsan that we're showing in all aspects of our life. When we worship Allah, we do it well. When we treat others, we treat them well. And we look at it as a form of worship. And there's not one exact way to do it. Each and every one of us is going to be in situations where we're faced with things, and we have to make the decision, am I going to do this or that? And your heart will tell you what's the better path. That's why it's called ma'ruf, because it's known to the heart. Your heart will tell you what is the best thing to do in that situation. You can't run to a parent and say, what should I do? You can't run to a chef and say, what should I do? Only you know what to do in that situation. Yes, we go to our parents for advice. We go to the shuyukh and the teachers in our community to know, what has Allah said that I have to do in this situation? And what might be recommended? But when we're put in that situation of wondering, which path do I take? What choice do I make? Do I do this with ihsan, with excellence, or am I going to transgress? Am I going to use the blessings of Allah to do this well, or am I going to ignore that and deny the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? But once we do that, we should know that the rahmah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He tells us, those people of ihsan, the muhsineen, the rahmah of Allah is close. And how can it be close? There's many different ways of how it can be close. One of the things they mentioned is that it lets society function. The more ihsan that we have in society, the more functioning of a society that we have. The example that I give is the courtesy that you have as a driver. Imagine if we did it as drivers, we only said, this is my right, this is my haq, and we're not courteous to other drivers. Imagine what the freeways would look like if we weren't courteous. But courtesy comes out of ihsan. That's all right, I'm going to slow down and let you merge onto this very traffic, during this very high traffic time. But if we force and we say, no, this is my right, this is my haq, and we don't show ihsan, imagine what our society would look. So it lets society function at a higher level. And there are some people who say that if you want to look at a civilization, don't look at their achievements of the dunya. That's what I mentioned earlier before. Don't look at their achievements of the dunya. Look at the courtesy that they extend to other people. So we might go to a so-called developing nation or a third world country, and they don't have all of the dunya that we see here in America, but look at the way they treat people. Look at that. That's civilization. That's what a civilization is about. It's not about building the best buildings, because Fir'aun had that. But he didn't have ihsan towards the people, so all of that was meaningless. Allah will be with you when you have ihsan. When you're trying to be conscious on your day-to-day interactions with other people, and when you try to show this perfection and this excellence of our faith, and your ihsan, Allah will be close to you and answer your du'as. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will love us. And when He puts love of us, when He puts love of us in the hearts of other people, huge changes will occur. And protection will ensue. One of the things they mention is that in the society, you will be protected. Just look at the best example is the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. How was he known to the people of Quraysh? Did they call him Muhammad? Or did they call him Al-Amin, the trustworthy? Because he was showing this ihsan to them all of the time. So even when the oppression started because of his message, he was given a lot of protection that the other believers weren't given. He was given a lot more protection because of his position. And other people the same. That Uthman radiallahu anhu, because of his ihsan towards other people, he was given a position in society and protection from the society. Another benefit to us as individuals, your heart will be at ease. We know what it feels like. Every one of us knows what it feels like when you do something good to another person. When you do something good to another animal, or to an animal. We know that feeling, and we know the feeling that comes when we do something bad to another person. We know that feeling. So imagine what our hearts will feel like if we pile up bad interactions, buggy interactions, bully interactions, inappropriate interactions with other people. And imagine what our hearts will feel like and our bodies will be less free of stress if we have ihsan to other people.
Another thing is that it will remove diseases of the heart. So physically, you will be it'll reduce the stress. But even spiritually, it can remove diseases of the heart. Recently, somebody asked me, he said, I have enmity between me and another person. What can I do? I said, show that person ihsan. This is something the scholars mentioned, that if you do good to that person, even somebody that's between you and him, enmity as mentioned in the Quran, you will find that person becomes a close friend. Because we are by our nature, Allah has made us, that we love the people who are good to us. We show ihsan. When we go against our nature, then we mess up that imbalance. There's a story, Allahu A'lam if it's true, but there was a man who was really good to a king, a cook or something, he was something and he had some job in the castle. And then one day he made the king angry and the king said, I'm going to execute you. And he said, okay, but just give me 10 days in the prison. And he said, the way I'm going to execute you is that I'm going to throw you in the prison and have my dogs eat you, attack and kill you. And so he said, okay, but just give me 10 days with the dogs in prison before you unleash them on me. He said, okay. So during that 10 days, this person who was going to be executed showed ihsan to the animals. He started feeding them, petting them, caring for them. And by the end of the day, they became his close friends. When the king came and he said, now I'm going to throw you to these animals, he said, okay, and he saw what happened when he threw them to the animals. And then this man, who was a very wise man, told the king, he said, I did ihsan to you for years. Look at how you treated me. One mistake and you wanted to execute me. These dogs, which are lower than humans, I treated them nicely for 10 days, and look at how well they're close to me and how protective they are of me. And so the king, of course, he realized his mistake. But this is some of the benefits that we can get when we show ihsan to other people, even those people that might be enemies or those creatures, we can draw them closer. And then finally, the levels of ihsan are clearly mentioned in the Quran, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَعْبُدُ اللَّهَ وَلَا تُشْرِكُ بِهِ شَيْئًا. Worship Allah, and do not associate partners with Allah. وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا. And show ihsan to our parents. So when we're beginning our levels to say, okay, now this ihsan, this pillar of my faith, where do I begin? Where do I start? Let's start with our interaction with my parents. Am I being good to them? Am I taking care of them? Let me increase. Let me always excel. Let me perfect. And if any point we get to a point where we think that we've achieved perfection, if we're sincere and we look at that, we can always excel. We can do something even better. So let's start with our parents and analyze and see if our relationship with our parents is good and is we're doing it as best we can. وَبِذِي الْقُرْبَى, and with our family. وَالْيَتَامَى, and the poor and the orphans. Are we really having ihsan with them? Are we creating a society where they feel honored and they feel that there's a place to go to? Do they feel that a person can come to me as a muhsin, as a person of ihsan? Sometimes we're bothered when people come and ask us for favors. But the wise people say, actually look at that as a benefit. They're praising you. Because Allah has put the question with somebody else. It's not you that's coming to ask for money or advice or help. That's somebody else coming to you. And they see you as a person of ihsan. They see you as a person of goodness. And this is what the Prophet ﷺ described it or taught us to be. That we should be amongst the people, we should stand out. We should be able to stand out. And this doesn't mean that we have a specific dress that we wear to stand out. But what this means is that people can tell that we are people of ihsan. And when they see that we're people of ihsan, then they'll come to us. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us from the people of ihsan, to make us of the muhsineen, to make us of those who excel and perfect in our faith and in our worship. And ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us ihsan and to give us the pillar of ihsan in all of our interactions with other people and in worshiping Him. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم ولسائر المسلمين.